Congressman, please heed the call. Don't stand in the doorway, don't block up the hall. For he that gets hurt will be he who has stalled. For the battle outside raging will soon shake your windows and rattle your walls. For the times, they are a-changing.
Thus, this three-judge panel has declared North Carolina's speaker ban law unconstitutional. This decision ends a wrangle which began in the closing days of the 1963 General Assembly of North Carolina. In the June of that year, under suspension of the rules, the lawmakers passed the bill forbidding known communists or pleaders of the Fifth Amendment from speaking on state-supported campuses. In November 1965, on recommendations of a special study commission, a special session of the legislature turned jurisdiction over campus speakers back to the chancellors of each campus. A suit was then filed March 31, 1966, against the state of North Carolina and the University of North Carolina, testing the constitutionality of that law. Plaintiffs in the suit included Paul Dixon III, then the student body president at UNC Chapel Hill, and 11 other students, and Dr. Herbert Apthecker and Frank Wilkinson. Apthecker is head of the American Institute of Marxist Studies, and Wilkinson seeks to abolish the House Un-American Activities Committee. Both men made talks at UNC Chapel Hill in March of 1966, but off-campus property in those famous across-the-wall talks.
They said it was the biggest news story, the speaker ban story overall, of the year. So apparently there was a lot of state coverage with Amity Doubt.
Was it yesterday in the course of the hearings that someone raised the prospect that a communist who may cheer for one team or the other is technically in violation of this statute?
It's the only time in all the years of my association with the university that I ever lost a vote in the trustees of the institution, but they turned me down on my petition, which was one of Chancellor Aycock and all the rest, to keep the freedom that we had, maintain the tradition of the place.
By choosing these means of regulation, we have established a practice that is contrary to the great and honored tradition of free and open discussion in North Carolina.
Paul Sharp was our chancellor at that time. He'd succeeded Bill Aycock, and he approved, and Bill Friday, our president, approved, and it went to the trustees, and Dan K. Moore said, you can't have them.
And I guess the moment of greatest embarrassment to me was the day that these two men, over whom all this controversy generated, stood out here on the sidewalk on Franklin Street, and several thousand students were on this side of the rock wall, so they could say what they wanted to say to the student body, and we could not and would not permit that to happen on campus. That was the saddest day of my experience.
So there were invitations from the SDS, and there were invitations from the Paul Dixon student body group.
SDS, Students for a Democratic Society. It has a critique built into it. It suggests we're not living in a democratic society. Yet we're all.
It doesn't say students in a democratic society, does it?
For a democratic society.
And Apthecker and Wilkinson said they'd come.
It was audacious to invite a communist and someone who'd taken the Fifth Amendment to come to the campus and speak. You know, that was Gary's idea. And SDS was known coast to coast as an organization that would do those kinds of things. It was audacious.
This is 40 years ago now. My first recollection of SDS was being in the library looking at Dissent magazine, which was a socialist magazine. And there was not a story, but an advertisement from SDS in there. They had just released a document, the founding document, called the Port Huron Statement. And it sounded interesting, and I sent off for it, got a copy of it. And then the Berkeley Free Speech Movement had a big impact on students. Actually, I think Bettina Apthecker, Herbert Apthecker's daughter, who we wound up inviting, I think Bettina was one of the leaders of the free speech movement at the time, kind of a historical continuity there. And Mario Savio's speech was very moving.
We'll do something which hasn't occurred at this university in a good long time. We're going to have real classes up there. But they're going to be freedom schools conducted up there. We're going to have classes on the First and 14th Amendments.
Yeah, the free speech movement was crucial, I think.
I am Dr. Edward Strong, Chancellor of the Berkeley campus. I have an announcement. This assemblage has developed to such a point that the purpose and work of the university have been materially impaired.
And that's when we went to the other student organizations and said, guys, you can't sit on the fence anymore. We're going to do this. You make a decision. You are either for free speech or you're for suppressing free speech. So which side are you going to jump? There's no more talk of compromising at this point. And several of those organizations, they took the principled stand at that point and joined with us.
In fact, I talked to Apthicker on the telephone and to urge him to come. And he said, well, he didn't want to be arrested. And I said, well, you don't have to be arrested. What you do is you come here, and you'll be escorted by the student body president up to Silent Sam, where you will then address the crowd, and you will be told you can't speak on the campus, and you can leave and go back to New York. And it won't take you. You can fly down in the morning and leave in the evening. And he said, okay, but he did not want to be arrested. Frank Wilkinson didn't mind being arrested.
We didn't want Apthicker to get arrested if he didn't have to. And he was willing to. I think Wilkinson had more of a problem about that, as I recall.
I think I remember, I really want to be cautious about these things because memory is fallible and can be awfully self-serving. But I think I recall Frank Wilkinson's speech here, as I recall his ultimate one at Chapel Hill. He spoke twice, once across the wall, which was, I must say, a clever idea. I don't know whose it was. But it dramatized the absurdity of the whole thing by having him have to shout across the wall to willing students.
The particular meeting I remember that was so, seemed to me so a memorable event was a meeting in Dan Pollitt's little tiny basement office in the old law school. And I think Gary Waller was there, Jerry Carr was there, I was there, Dan was there, and there may have been one or two other people, I can't remember really. And this is where Dan hatched his idea, or brought to us his idea, Dan Pollitt, of Frank Wilkinson standing on a chair and speaking over the wall, and all the students sitting on campus, so that he wasn't on campus. But he was speaking to them over the wall, which, you know, sort of symbolically, like the Berlin Wall, you know, is on, which, you know, had been built just a few years before that. It just seemed like such a brilliant stroke. And we all thought so. We all thought, this is a great idea. Here's a way of kind of nonviolently and with a tremendous symbolic, it seemed to us, symbolic power. Mocking, really, the foolishness of the speaker ban law.
But the main point was to make our point. Here he is, he's ready to speak, and he's not going to be allowed to speak. The thing I remember the most was that confrontation on Silent Sam between Beaumont and Apthicker was great.
Chief Beaumont, you know, he was head of campus security. He looked real rough. He looked like his nose had been broken five or six times, and he spoke with a New York cop accent, but which he was. When we were planning the demonstrations for Apthicker and Wilkinson, we kept Chief Beaumont informed all the time exactly what was going to happen. There wasn't going to be any surprises. There wasn't going. We didn't want anything to get out of hand with regard to the confrontation, especially of Apthicker. I know he asked me the night before. Now, where is this going to happen, and what is it you want me to say again? And so I said, well, you got to say you got to uphold the law and not going to let him speak if that's what you're bound to do. And he said, well, that's what I have to do. And I said, well, make sure that you say it so everybody can hear it. And he said, all right, everybody will hear me.
And then can I explain that to
you? You can't explain
here?
Anything, sir. You know you're breaking the law, and we obey the laws here, whether you like it or not.
I don't know that I'm breaking any law.
You are breaking the law, and I'm the... Well, I'm in charge of police, and I'm telling you that.
You're telling me that. Now I know it. I didn't know it before.
You haven't been informed?
No.
You didn't know about a speaker ban law?
I know about the speaker ban, but I didn't know that this was a law.
I thought I was a citizen of the United States, and I thought I had the rights.
My dad was a KA, Kappa Alpha, and they fly a Dixie flag, or did then. And Silent Sam sort of seemed to be, you know, the ultimate KA, a Dixiecrat. And not having been a son of the Confederacy, although I was born in it, I really don't think I could get in touch with what would motivate people in what is probably the 20th century to put up a memorial to the Confederacy. I guess I should have paid more attention. Those who were the most vocal spokesmen for the demonstration, who were the organizers, the impetus behind it, were not mainstream Carolina students. They were probably older than average. They were better than average students for the most part. They were critical thinkers, and I think most of us weren't.
Chief Beaumont has informed us that Dr. Aftecker may not speak on the campus. We will therefore move to the other side of the wall. I would request that you, the student body, stay on this side so that you don't interrupt traffic.
It's fairly easy to remember because I came down this sidewalk and ended up at the tree there on Franklin Avenue right next to the wall. I somehow wormed my way in and was leaning out this way to try to get a view around people, and I'm sure I probably was right on the boundary and leaned out over the wall to get a better view.
I am very sorry that my appearance at your university has really turned into a spectacle and some kind of a circus.
I remembered what I was thinking when Aftecker first began to speak. And what I thought was, he could easily be shot. And I just remembered thinking that. Because I was in front of him, listening to him speak, and I was looking across Franklin Street at the buildings over there. And I was thinking, man, he would be an easy target.
The main thing here is, of course, not only the violation of my rights as a citizen of the United States, but infinitely of greater consequence, your rights as citizens of the United States and students who are seeking to understand and learn, your right to listen to whomever you wish to listen to.
Speaker ban law was probably one of the most educational phenomena in my whole experience as a professor at the University of North Carolina. I think they did more for democracy than anything that ever happened here.
I don't think anybody walked away from that meeting at the wall without a heightened sensitivity to what was at stake there.
It was taking too much time to shoot us from their classes. Instead of being out there marching, I would have been having a head in the books and learning.
I was 19 at the time, and I'm not sure I'd ever had two consecutive serious thoughts by that point. And the speaker ban sort of was the catalyst to kick my political consciousness into gear. I don't think I fully understood up until that day what the obligation of an individual citizen is to stand up and be counted.
The speaker ban law didn't change anything, truthfully. I don't think it changed anything. It was a shame to have to waste our time and attention on it when there were many more important things to do. It didn't stop the civil rights movement. It didn't stop free speech on campus. It didn't prevent the Vietnam War debates. So really, it was a pain in the ass. But at the same time, it gave us a focus and a renewed sense of our own principles, I guess.
The possibility of democracy and free speech and equality and so forth. It was just a wonderful, wonderful time. It changed my life permanently for the better.
Jerry and I are not terribly nostalgic. We don't sit around and dwell on this stuff. Oh, the good old days stuff. But I remember it as something that really empowered me to go forward and try to help organize around the war, that people would respond if given the true story, that you know you could break through all the penumbra of media and official discussion and get through to people. But you had to work at it. And it was fun because you were meeting people, you were discussing stuff with people, you'd see people change. That was a lot of fun.
I think we're all learning. We're learning that everything's not all bad about communism, everything's not all good about Americanism. But I think there's enough differences. I don't want any part of communism.
Several weeks ago in Winston-Salem, before a law school group at Wake Forest, I made a complete statement concerning this law. At that time, I felt, and I still feel, that we should do nothing to encourage the Communist Party in this state and nation of ours. And I do not feel that we should give a platform on state property for a member of this party to advocate the overthrow of this country.
I knew Dan Moore from seeing him with my father before he was the governor. And I know that he was considered himself a great friend of the university, as did I think a lot of the people who were even in favor of the speaker ban.
Well, we didn't have anybody who was a known member of the Communist Party or who advocated the overthrow of the government. So they were not curing the problem that this law addressed, you know. So why did they do it?
I think the only thing that motivated Phil was his love of country and the threat he saw in an enemy country coming in here and sending their speakers and representatives here to demoralize their own people.
I think it's been stated by our State Department, by Mr. Hoover, head of our FBI, that a communist is a declared enemy of this country. And therefore, we felt that a communist should not be permitted to speak.
It was a piece of legislation written out of anger.
Not everybody that voted for it did it out of malevolent reasons. Some did.
Jesse Helms was at that time had a 5-minute program on the dominant television station, WRAL, out of Raleigh. And at 6:25 to 6:30 every evening, he would be on the air giving comments about the events of the day, and he was an extreme right-winger from my point of view. was a small little group. Bobby Morgan, who later became our senator, was one of them, and a few other, and they sprung it on, most of the legislators were surprised. And Bill Friday, who was the president of the university, and Bill Aycock, who was our chancellor, heard about it on a radio. I mean, that they were making this law for the universities. And they hopped in their cars and they drove over to Raleigh to protest, but they arrived too late, you know, so it was out of the blue.
It has always been my understanding that the speaker ban law was passed in the waning moments of the session, I think it was in 63, as a direct result of the integration sit-ins, primarily at the Sir Walter Hotel, where all of the legislators who weren't from Raleigh or Wake or the surrounding counties lived. They were trying to integrate the dining room at the Sir Walter. Now they may have said that these demonstrations were inspired by communist ideology. Whether they believe that or not, I severely doubt. And what my father told me was that all of that was just hoax. I have never heard anyone say anything to the contrary. That's what my father felt. That's what all of the legislators that I ever talked to felt.
And when you got a combination of the blacks or the Afro-Americans and these accusation that Martin Luther King was inclined, you know, toward communism, and Langston Hughes had been flirting with him, even though he was known as a poet more than anything else, and that's the reason he was invited to this campus. But when you put those two together, you got a mighty powerful political situation.
Some of the legislators were very angry with some of the university faculty people who had accosted them, if that's the right word, in front of the Sir Walter Hotel, where most of these people stayed. They'd been in confrontations, verbal confrontations, nothing physical. But a lot of tension was around it, and this was the way that Thad Ewer and some of the others thought that they could discipline the university. It was born of what was going on in the state of Ohio. It was not an original piece of legislation.
We were told that this bill was copied after the one that was in the Ohio legislature and had gone through. I think Thad Ewer told us that, or some of the members of the Senate. But we found out later that wasn't true, that they didn't put the bill through. They dumped the matter back in the hands of the trustees of the university and did what we should have done.
The bill in the Ohio legislature had been drafted in Ohio, so I knew it was the first of its kind. The reason why it failed, it was allowed to die in committee in Ohio. Jesse Helms, as I recall at the time, was even then not a senator, but was the principal commentator on WRAL. And to describe him as a ferocious anti-communist is hardly to defame him. I think he would probably welcome the description. So that may have been part of the mixture here, absent in Ohio.
I think that it's pretty clear that the speaker ban was aimed at Chapel Hill. Once it was passed, Jesse Helms took it up as being aimed at trying to get rid of the festering red sore on the state of North Carolina, which he called Chapel Hill.
Jesse Helms and I were friends before he ever got into politics. When he was in WRAL, it was WRAL radio then, we published his column, and it's one of the most popular features of the paper. So I regard him as the leading conservative in America for years.
I did not see what a skilled politician might have imagined, that if I were going to want to control the position of black people so that there would not be a civil rights movement, one of the beautiful ways to carry it out would be to say, we are under a great threat to the law and order of this country, from a subversive communist movement. We must tighten up all our structures to meet that. Something of what, frankly, is going on at the moment with the Patriot Act. And I would then, as a politically aware person, have seen how easily that was used and transposed into the issue of civil rights when it came up.
This is the first time in the history of the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill that a president of Duke University has been a commencement speaker on this campus.
The speaker ban law, in fact, has very little to do with subversion and nothing to do with communism of any significant sort.
I think that we have periods of crisis, and we make mistakes, and we suppress civil liberties, and then later on we regret it, and then we repeat the same mistakes when the next crisis comes along.
The purported fear of the communist ideology and the communist regime as causing our elected representatives to say the way to fight that fear is to somehow legislatively disallow it, to make people who espouse it pariahs. I think that is the exact opposite of what ought to happen. I think if we have people in this country who advocate the violent overthrow of the United States government by Al-Qaeda or by anyone else, they ought to be allowed to speak about it till they're blue in the face, because invariably these people turn out to be absolute nutcases.
In the 60s and the 70s, they had to frame people, or they had to do COINTELPRO type actions to try to incapacitate them. People were sent to jail who were framed. I mean, my dread always was that they were going to plant drugs on me and send me away for that, and I'm sure they did that to people. Today, under the Patriot Act, they can just make people disappear with no one knows where they are, and they have no access to attorneys, and they can be held indefinitely. That's a lot scarier than what we faced, but what we faced was scary enough.
At any given point, I think, in our history, if you were to put the Bill of Rights up for vote, I don't think it would pass. Depending on which particular problem was being addressed at which particular time and in which portion of the country. I think the framers of the Constitution were very wise to put it in. That's why it's hard to amend the Constitution.
The First Amendment to the Constitution includes the provision that Congress shall make no law establishing religion or impairing the free exercise or impairing the freedom of speech or the press or the right to assemble for redress of grievances. So the First Amendment to the Constitution says that Congress shall make no law impairing the freedom of speech. And that applies to the federal government. How about the states? Well, the 14th Amendment, which was adopted after the Civil War, says that no state shall interfere with the privileges and immunities of the citizens or deny equal protection of the laws or due process of laws. It doesn't say anything about free speech. It says equal protection and due processes and privileges and immunities. Well, the court in the 20s, the Supreme Court in the 20s, said that due process of the law includes the right to speak. So when you argue that North Carolina cannot ban the communist speech or speech by communists, the correct way to say it is because it denies due process under the 14th Amendment, which includes the free speech under the First Amendment. But usually you just say free speech.
Well, the idea that if Congress could make laws abridging that freedom of speech, which allows us access to a breadth of view, novelties, information, facts, which by their prohibition we will never learn in a lifetime, is to a certain extent to cheapen our lifetimes by diminishing what we might be as human beings. It's just a preposterous idea, frankly, to entrust to majoritarian bodies a capacity to stunt your entire life by deciding what it is you may never learn, and by never having learned it, never having had it affect you in any way at all. It's unimaginable that you would want to live in a world like that.
If you believe in that principle, which I really do, I think it's a terribly vital principle for this country, terribly vital, and I used it to the max in teaching all the years that I was able to teach in between the times I was fired, then the fight in Chapel Hill should have been turned by all involved, Friday and everybody else, into a matter of principle. And they should have said, on principle, we can't abide this law.
There was a university celebration of the speaker ban a few years ago, right? They invited me to come. I refused to come because I knew that it was this self-congratulatory, look how great the university was, we stood our ground thing. And I didn't want to be the guy standing up there on the stage when everybody's holding hands saying, oh no, you didn't. That's not the way it was.
Please understand that there was never a time in this entire episode that our first objective was not to remove the law. Well, the first, of course, was going immediately to the legislature and trying to get a reversal right there. And we came very close. If we had two senators to change their point of view, we wouldn't have had all this experience. That was a major defeat. Then the state resorted to commission strategy, to a whole lot of things except litigation, because I think anybody who studied constitutional law knew what was going to happen if you got it into federal court.
If we had lost our accreditation, the theory was that we couldn't compete in the bowl games, the football bowl games, or the Final Four basketball games. Well, that cast an entirely new light on this problem. So the legislature decided that they would appoint a commission to study the whole problem. And that was the Britt Commission, headed by Mr. Britt. And Mr. Britt had hearings in the summer of 65, I guess, and people appeared pro and con.
The American Legion supports the communist speaker law, which is now the subject of this inquiry.
Would the American Legion be willing to give this authority back to the university officials and the Board of Trustees if such a time, at such a time when that could be agreed upon?
I would have preferred and still prefer that it have been handled by the trustees, but in light of their indifference in the past, the American Legion would not be
willing to
do that. The best illustration that I can use of it is the illustration of Langston Hughes. Langston Hughes was a communist. He was also a poet. He was invited to speak on our university campus. He spoke here, I think even though they do not speak on communist subjects, we think the dignity that it adds to them can cause them to have greater influence than they deserve.
Do you believe that in the passage of such a law as the speaker ban law, that we tend to impose a totalitarian practice, which in fact is one of the basic reasons for our opposition to communism?
No. I do not. I believe at any time, Mr. Thornberry, that we legislate in order to preserve our country and to prevent what I believe and what Mr. Hoover calls a treason, that we are well within the prerogatives of a free democracy.
The Britt Commission was formed, and I was asked by Britt, if I wanted to speak, and he invited me to speak. And I called on Pete Ivey, who was in the news bureau, the director of it, to get me some of Jesse Helms' speech, particularly the ones that I had recalled that he made about the fairness doctrine.
I refer to the telecast of Mr. Jesse Helms on his program, Viewpoint. Now, Mr. Chairman, to avoid any misunderstanding of my purpose, permit me to emphasize that I turn to Mr. Helms because I endorse his clear expressions on the subject of freedom. He did so in connection with the renewal of the license of WRAL-TV by the Federal Communications Commission after this agency for several months had investigated alleged violations of the so-called fairness doctrine by the station.
The fairness doctrine was the Communications Commission was threatening to deprive the station of its freedom.
I now quote from the August 4, 1964 telecast of Mr. Helms. Quote, "Broadcasters," he says, "throughout the nation have long complained that the fairness doctrine is vague beyond comprehension, that it imposes obligations and responsibilities, and even that the FCC exceeded its authority in the adoption of a document which, as some of our newspaper friends now note, come close to an attempt at censorship," end of quote. Now, if you substitute educators for broadcasters, speaker ban law for fairness doctrine, and the General Assembly for FCC, and the result is an articulate statement of our viewpoint of the speaker ban law.
And that would be precisely what I've been saying all the while.
One real concern we feel with the speaker bill is that this legislation does deprive the duly elected trustees of their traditional and long-established authority to operate these state-supported institutions, and that by doing so, it is detrimental to the university in its relations, its standing, its functioning, and its future development.
We wanted to get rid of the restriction. However you do that, through accreditation, through litigation, through board internal mechanisms, we never wavered in our determination to defeat what was there.
Bill Friday has his view of the story. I have my view of the story. I think that the consistent message that was given to us was that compromise was in the works. Don't do anything. Don't do anything. This we got for 2.5 years or 3 years until the Brick Commission came out. We are going to solve it. Don't rock the we knew it was not going to get solved. And we used that time to make a lot of friends and agitate and educate on campus about it, because I knew it was not going to be solved.
Bill Friday kept saying, we're going to get the legislature to overturn this. But, you know, next time. And it just didn't happen. He could not make it happen.
Bill Friday is well liked and well respected by most people in the state. And when he says something, people listen. And he came out and spoke very boldly and frequently against the speaker ban law, and that made a big difference.
And the SDS kids, of course, were just kind of like, let's, bring this to a conflict, raise it to a point where something has to happen. We can't just wait. That's the way they were.
So I think Bill Friday was caught. I think he was caught between a lot of conflicting forces. I think he's a very, very bright man. And I, whatever he may have said behind closed doors, the message that was coming down on the street, as they say, was that the principal wound inflicted on the university is that it has been taken out of our hands, we're going to put it back of our hands, and we're going to take care of it. And to prove that they could do it, they spent a couple of years being as hard as the state legislature would have been about who could speak on campus. To demonstrate that it was that they could be trusted, they cracked down on the students and on who could speak. They turned down Arthur Miller, for crying out loud, from speaking under the speaker ban. There were a couple famous cases of European scientists who were communists who couldn't come to campus because of this. And there were other cases.
Well, one of the things that got a lot of conversation was that I think during the last stages when the speaker ban was in effect, there was sort of a Jubilee weekend planned. And the theme was hootenanny. So it was going to be bluegrass and folk music and blues. And some of the early indications, and I guess they were even previewed in the Daily Tar Heel, were for people like Joan Baez and Bob Dylan and Peter, Paul and Mary, and names that were at the top of their genre of music. And as I remember it, most of those ended up being canceled, and sort of the most politically controversial group that actually showed up was Flattened Scruggs. And I was a fan of these artists. And I took their lyrics to be challenging the misbehavior of America in violation of its own principles. I certainly didn't take it to be subversive in any way.
All of that was part of Bill Friday and his administration proving to the state legislature that they could be trusted was suppressing free speech on campus.
If a university is to suffer these kinds of infringements on academic freedom and freedom of speech, they ought not do it themselves. That they may not be able to overcome others, and sometimes not even in courts, may be understandable, but they ought not do it to themselves. And they did.
It was suggested to me, by a member of the faculty right here in the university, that I violate the law to set up a lawsuit. And I kind of laughed about it and said, well, you got to keep in mind that I took an oath in Kenan Stadium on October 12, 1957, administered by the Chief Justice of the North Carolina Supreme Court, Justice Stanley Winburn, that I would obey the laws and the Constitution of the United States and of the state. And I don't believe, as long as I'm in this job, that I will violate my oath of office.
You have to remember an ancient Indian proverb. You never know what the forces were in the chief's mind till you stand in the chief's moccasins. And that's why I'm not critical of things that I see in public life until I really understand what the cross currents were.
Bill Friday was probably one of the 10 people on the planet that my dad had deep respect for. And I can remember some of his early statements, and it was like, well, sure. Doesn't everybody see that? And the fact that he had opposition from the Board of Trustees was almost unthinkable to me. It seemed like his position was so tempered and so moderate, so steeped in the law that nobody could possibly disagree with it. But he was overruled.
And so much of this is done out of the public view, because that's the nature of the democracy we live in. And I must have spent 100 hours a week. You never, never was it out of your life until it was adjudicated. And I'm not saying this as a complaint. It's a fact of life if you're going to be a university administrator.
Because I have no right to say for sure that the law would be unconstitutional. I thought it would be, but administrators who take oath to obey law has no right to violate it because they think it might be held unconstitutional. That's just my personal opinion.
If you have law without principle operating, it's a empty law.
We had a particular strategy worked out, Carlisle and I did, that would permit the speaking to take place. That was the decision, no. In retrospect, I now understand I couldn't have changed the majority. I didn't care what I did. And if I were going to file suit against the university, then I would have had to resign.
Free speech is a principle worth losing your job over, worth offending the legislature over. It's a principle that rises above the immediate politics of the situation.
I had time left on prescribed time before I had chosen to go back to the law school. And I intended to use that time to try to help educate the people to the seriousness of this law and I had nothing that I thought was more vital to the university to do. And the last thing that I wanted to do was to resign in protest. I don't know that that helps very much. And I wouldn't be as effective if I just, in a fit of emotion, resigned. No, I wouldn't do it.
Resignation doesn't solve any problem that I can see. You're there to fight the battle. I've often said if the trustees had found out what I was doing, they should have fired me right then. My principal effort, once I lost in the Board of Trustees, was with Paul. I felt fairly certain that what Paul was doing was going to bring this to an end, because I knew they weren't going to file suit against the law. So that was the way it worked itself out. This university is forever in the debt of Paul Dixon for doing what he did. One of the great tragedies of my life is that young man was killed in a car wreck so soon thereafter that. But he rendered a very noble service to this place. And McNeil Smith, I'm going to give him credit too.
Bill Friday was great in his speeches and his behind the scenes, and Aycock was great, and Sitterson was great, and the faculty resolutions were helpful. And all that laid the groundwork, which may have influenced the court. But the Dixon and the other student leaders got McNeil Smith to file the lawsuit.
That's fine. Let Mr. Dixon get the credit, have his name in the law books. That wasn't what we were interested in. And one of the reasons we wanted them on board in this process was they had resources we didn't have. And they could do tasks that we either couldn't do or weren't interested in doing. And they did it, much to their credit.
They were not burning draft cards, and they were not burning flags, or they were not lying down in the streets, and they were not holding anybody captive. They came to court, and that's exactly what every citizen ought to do and ought to expect to get justice when they come.
The three-judge panel noted that the law was vague. In reference to known members of the Communist Party, they asked, known to whom, to what degree of certainty, and a member in what sense? In referring to advocating the overthrow of the Constitution of the United States or of North Carolina, they asked, does this mean by force or by ideas? In reference to pleading of the Fifth Amendment, they said this presumably means self-incrimination, but this is a matter of conjecture. The three-judge panel also noted that policy and procedures of the schools suffer from the same infirmity as does the law. They also pointed out that recently the United States Supreme Court has made loyalty oaths unconstitutional. Thus, with this action, North Carolina no longer has a speaker ban law. This is Ted Harrison reporting for Channel 2 News.
That freedom in the sense that this debate identified is so fundamental to the American enterprise and higher education that it ought not even be debated. It ought to be assumed by every thoughtful, living American.
Will President of the University, William Friday, I have the honor to present John Fitzgerald Kennedy, who has been recommended by the faculty and approved by the Board of Trustees for the degree of Doctor of Laws.
North Carolina has long been identified with enlightened and progressive leaders and people, and I can think of no more important reason for that reputation than this university. We move for the first time in our history through an age in which two opposing powers have the capacity to destroy each other. And while we do not intend to see the free world give up, we shall make every effort to prevent the world from being blown up.
It shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
People forget John Kennedy won the election in 60 by out-hawking Nixon. He accused Nixon of having been soft and the Eisenhower administration of allowing a missile gap to open. And Kennedy was seen as the guy who was going to take American interests against the communists into the field. Kennedy, after all, started the Green Berets and significantly escalated the war in Vietnam. the anti-communism issue is not owned by one party or the other. They both have got their sins.
Because the war on terror will require resolve and patience, it will also require firm moral purpose. In this way, our struggle is similar to the Cold War. Now as then, our enemies are totalitarians, holding a creed of power with no place for human dignity. Now as then, they seek to impose a joyless conformity to control every life and all of life.
This country's got the opportunity of a lifetime, really. We've worked 200 years or more to build up to this level of dominance. But as General Shelton said, and I think he was infinitely right, a bit of humility is certainly important in the American character in a way we don't really see today. Unilateralism has no place in the world. You've got to get along with your brothers and sisters and children. What we've got to have here is a sense of grace about what we've been blessed to get and go on from there.
I think of a remark of Abraham Lincoln's when a little lady came to him at the height of the Civil War agony and said, "Oh, Mr. Lincoln, isn't it wonderful to know that God is on our side in this fearful conflict?" And he looked down at her, said, "Madam, I would rather be assured that I were on his side in this fearful conflict."
I've learned to hate Russians all through my whole life. If another war comes, it's them we must fight. To hate them and fear them, to run and to hide. You never ask questions when God's on your side. Too many dark hours I've been thinking about this.
Moral truth is the same in every culture, in every time, and in every place.
We've moved away from separation of church and state in America right now. And we're getting where politicians, Franklin Graham's appeal to the meeting in Charlotte this week, get behind President Bush, 5,000 ministers sitting in the audience. That wouldn't have happened here years and years ago. That Thomas Jefferson's curtain is beginning to fall. That's something that needs some clarification too. But it's the university's job, you see, to raise these issues, talk about them, educate people about them, educate students to them, and go on.
Some of the things they say about President Bush are really asinine, ridiculous. They accuse the president of things that no decent man would be guilty of. But the Russian people, they can't question the government over there. They can't stand up and make a speech criticizing the president the way we can.
When you put it in the context of how other capitalist countries could accommodate themselves and live with communist and socialist parties and have socialist governments, we were very extreme and very peculiar. And to ban, you know, there again, this kind of the provincial nature of this country and in the country of the South, and in the South, you know, North Carolina and Chapel Hill.
This is the period, the hysteria. This was the Cold War period. We went to excesses. We, just like right now, we're going to excesses. So in the war on terror, we have to lock people up for without counsel and so on. And that's the way it was in the McCarthy days. We regret McCarthyism now, but at the time, everybody was for McCarthyism.
Then in retrospect, people look back and say, well, I guess the menace really never was that great, but it was awfully hard to see it at the time. We risk doing it now under the Patriot Act. They did it in 1798, in the Sedition Act. The strange thing is that grown people need not know a lot of history to know that much from history. So if we know that in the past, the pressure of circumstances has given us an exaggerated anxiety, I don't know why we can't learn from those pasts, and therefore take a more sober view to today's emergency, and perhaps put it in more moderate setting as well. But we don't seem to be able to carry out that lesson.
There are many similarities, but it took a very, very different form. It seems to me the speaker ban was, you know, almost sort of a local event, as against what we're doing now. In many ways, what was happening now probably could be described as worse than the speaker ban period.
The idea of holding people without trial, without recourse, legal recourse, for long periods of time, or even what's gone on in Guantanamo, this worries me. And I think it would worry anybody who's concerned about civil liberties.
Is it unpatriotic to criticize your policies?
Absolutely not.
You suggested that last week in the Senate.
I did not state that, nor did I suggest it.
You said it helped America's
I did not
terrorists.
Say criticizing my policies or the things that I'm working on helps terrorists. I said for people to raise a false specter of lost civil liberties to just for fear-mongering and not to tell the truth about what we're doing obviously is helpful to our enemies.
One part, which is the easy part to disagree with, is the part that says that the FBI, without a warrant, can go into a library and find out what people are reading. And then it's illegal for the librarian to tell the person that the FBI has been around. So where's the freedom to read if everything you read goes to the FBI? And the same is true of records and so on. So there's Big Brother is monitoring what you read. And then there is the sneak and peek provision of the Patriot Act, where it authorizes the FBI or whoever to go sneak into your house, peek around, and then leave, leaving no trace. And I say that's burglarizing. And you can do this not with a warrant issued by a federal judge, but by a special court where they don't need probable cause. We have a secret court that meets in secret in the top floor of the Department of Justice. Here's the government, issues warrants without probable cause. They've not rejected a warrant ever, a request. And then the people go in and sneak and peek. That's not America.
I personally think there are a great number of portions of the Patriot Act that are probably unconstitutional. Some on their face, some may be unconstitutional as applied. And these lawsuits will work their way through the courts and we'll get who knows what kind of reception they'll get. It may depend on the makeup of the Supreme Court now, or it may depend on the makeup of the Supreme Court later. But these are the kind of issues that all citizens have to be very, very mindful of.
This is the second time that a federal judge in California has declared a section of the large and complex Patriot Act unconstitutional. This particular one involves a part of the Patriot Act that makes it a federal crime to provide, as the act says, expert advice or assistance to groups that are designated foreign terrorist organizations. And the challengers here said that is simply too broad. Certainly it should be a crime to engage in a criminal conspiracy with a terrorist group, but just to give them advice or talk to them violates the First Amendment, and the federal judge today agreed.
It's unbelievable to someone who grew up in my age to think that our government is doing these sorts of things, all in the name of to fight terrorism. Well, the way to fight terrorism is to abide by the Bill of Rights and the Constitution and be a shining bright light on the top of the hill as a beacon for all people all over the world because we're good, and not to jettison our Bill of Rights in a moment of passion.
I think every once in a while, a democracy has to redefine itself. We're in that process in this country right now. We were then. We were so afraid of the communists, you know, we'd see them under every bush. Nobody talks about communists today at all. We're off on this terrorist business now, so we have a piece of legislation passed that says, tries to regulate free speech, so forth and so on. We better look at that kind of legislation very carefully, because there are a lot of other nations around the world that are beginning to establish themselves. They watch what happens in America much more than we believe they do. And what I mean by that is, if they see the allegation of freedom but the fact of denial, they're not going to follow it.
Prior restraint of speech and the restraint of one's liberties, students, faculties, anybody's, is simply never a good idea. And it's worthwhile for citizens not to be intimidated by allegations of lack of patriotism or anything else. The most patriotic thing you can do to stand up for your civil rights and your civil liberties.
Apartment of my car, looking everywhere, I couldn't find them. I was looking in the sink and behind the chair, I was looking for them reds everywhere. I looked way up a chimney hole, looked deep down inside my toilet bowl, they got away. Sitting home alone, I started to sweat. I figured they was in my TV set. I peeked behind the picture frame, got a shock from my feet, hit me in the brain. Them reds did it. I know they did, them hardcore ones. I quit my job so I could work all alone, and I changed my name to Sherlock Holmes. Following some clues from my detective bag, I discovered there was red stripes in the American flag. Oh, Betsy Ross. Now, Eisenhower, he's a Russian spy. Lincoln, Jefferson, and that Roosevelt guy, to my knowledge, there's just one man that's really a true American. George Lincoln Rockwell. I know for a fact he hates commies because he picketed the movie Exodus. Well, I finally started thinking straight when I run out of things to investigate. Couldn't imagine doing anything else, and now I'm home investigating myself. Hope I don't find out anything. Good God.